Thanks, Klaus. Let's move on to Karolina Kaczor-Urbanowitz from UCLA. She'll talk about bioinformatic analysis of salivary RNA for biomarker development. Joel from Yale may have mentioned a bit before that, or several people mentioned that saliva has a lot of microbial RNA. So this is an interesting, saliva is an interesting biofluid to look at. Karolina?
Good afternoon. I shared just my slides. Just let me know if you can see them.
Yep, looks good.
Okay. So first of all, thank you very much for inviting me to give a talk today during the online workshop. And today I have a pleasure in presenting some new insights in the bioinformatic analysis of human salivary RNA sequencing data in the biomarker development process. So sorry, my presentation is stuck.
Uh-oh.
Yes, it's okay. First of all, I would like to present some short outlines. So I will show our major biomarker development project that was funded by the NIH and developed in Professor Dr. David Wong's lab. And it was funded for the previous 5 years. And then genesis of the development of the additional studies. And I will highlight also the development of new collaborations, both within and outside ERCC. I will present the aim of the current project, the future directions, and also I will speak shortly about the values, what you can take on from my talk for the whole ERCC community. So our major focus was on gastric cancer study. So gastric cancer, as we know, is one of the most common cancer worldwide, and the 5-year survival rate in the United States is less than 15%. Then what is important that the diagnosis is often delayed due to lack of early symptoms. So when it's diagnosed, it's usually at very late stage. The incidence of gastric cancer in the United States is not so prevalent, not so high. However, in Korea, this kind of the cancer is really very much prevalent, and there are specific factors that can contribute to the development of the gastric cancer, like, for example, age more than 55 years old, being male more than female, but also some specific factors like smoking, alcohol consumption, and also bacterial infections, specifically like Helicobacter pylori infection or Epstein-Barr virus infections. And that's why in Korea, there was developed the national insurance program to perform the endoscopy every 2 years for each of the, for all the people who are more than 40 years old. Why? Because there are great benefits of early detection of gastric cancer and its early treatment. So of course we can increase the survival rate. And also if we detect gastric cancer at earlier stage, it can be much more curable. And this is our project that we were performing for the past 5 years. It was funded by the NIH and in Professor David Wong's lab in collaboration with Dr. Yong Kim lab at the UCLA. So our major aim was to develop salivary extracellular RNAs biomarkers for gastric cancer detection. And this project was composed of several major steps, like the biomarker discovery that we did on 200 of the samples, 100 GC and 100 control, followed by the verification and definitive validation that was stepwise. So in the first phase, we did the individual marker validation with the panel development in a big, big cohort of 500 GC and 500 control patients. And then another validation of the panel in 250 gastric cancer patients and 250 control. And our aim was to develop those biomarkers and later on aim for the FDI approval. So in the study, we highlight not only the discovery phase, but mainly the validation, definitive validation, and the prospective design. During the performance of the study, we developed a lot of collaborations and both outside the ERCC and within. So the outside the ERCC, we were working with the Samsung Medical Center in South Korea. And thanks to them, we never had any problems with the sample procurement. We were always receiving the samples to our lab ahead of the time. And also during the performance of the main project, we developed some new ideas. So there was done the whole bioinformatic analysis of both long and short RNA sequencing data. And also additionally, Dr. Joel Rozovsky group did for us the microbial analysis. But what was surprising for us that we could not detect in our cohort any Helicobacter pylori genes that, and we know that Helicobacter pylori is one of the major risks for developing the gastric cancer. So when we took a more deeper insight in this analysis, it appeared that the most common databases, the microbial databases, they only contain the European strains of this bacteria, but not the Asian specific ones. So when we did additional analysis, we received very promising results. We also developed another collaboration with the NCI Institute, with Dr. Rapkin, Charles, and also with Dr. Constanza Camargo, and similarly work to develop some Epstein-Barr virus, exRNAs, and we received also very promising results. So why RNA sequencing of saliva can be, you know, like so challenging? So we know that it requires isolation of sufficient amount of RNA from saliva, which is not so easy task, and also adequate library construction. And there is lack of any standards or unification of the bioinformatic procedures that, that are specifically designed for processing of the saliva. That's why it encourages us to perform our study. And saliva is really unique, but because it origins from the salivary glands, from the microbiota, from lining cells, from blood and blood derivatives, extrinsic substances, and other fluids also. So it's very important diagnostic fluid that can be used for detection of the biomarkers for both oral and systemic diseases. And what is unique that we detected that saliva has really a lot of microbial exRNAs in the sequencing data. And also during the performance of the study, when we collaborated with Dr. Joel Rozovsky team, we find out that the QC quality control standards that were, you know, very applicable to all other biofluids for saliva, they were not so applicable because only saliva did not pass initially any of those ones. So actually, when we checked our samples and it appeared that our samples didn't have any DNA contamination, they were of really good quality, we developed together like the quality control that could be applicable to all the biofluids, including saliva. So saliva can be compared to other biofluids also. So we are very grateful having the pleasure to interact with DMRR group, with Dr. Joy Rozovsky. And actually what we did, we wanted to focus on specifically on the salivary RNA sequencing data by informatic analysis in order to set the standards for the processing of the saliva, human saliva data. And we developed two pipelines. One was one included the alignment of the raw reads to the directly to the human genome. The other pipeline included the filtering of the bacterial genes. So firstly, we would do the alignment to the microbiome, and then we was filtering out those reads, and the left reads, we would do the alignment to the human genome after filtering out of those bacterial ones. And actually, not only those sequence and filtering of those bacterial reads was important, but we spotted also that in case of saliva, the stringency of the criteria played a critical role also. And after our investigation, we think that for the saliva, the best approach in processing of the long RNA sequencing data, it would be that we will do the filtering out of the bacterial genes before we will do the alignment to the human genome, if we are interested of finding those any biomarkers for development of the diseases. And and in this way, we could get rid of any erroneous results, like, for example, the bacteria reads that were mapped to the human genome, but incorrectly. And we published our results in the Bioinformatics. It was in 2017. But actually, today, I would like to concentrate on our new approach. So I would like to present the bioinformatic analysis. So we went further and we investigated the human salivary RNA sequencing data. So we still would prefer for the long RNA sequencing data to filter out the bacterial leads before doing alignment to the human genome, but we introduced two new steps. One is the deconvolution and the variance partition, and the output of this analysis would be used like the input for the further differential expression, so for the comparison case control, because we can correct for those factors that were significant in the deconvolution or variance partition analysis. So I will elaborate a little bit more now. So actually, we know that we found out that the analysis of the human data sets, and if we deal with the human data sets running the standard differential expression, like the case versus control, like gastric cancer versus control, work not so efficiently, and we saw it already. So the idea is to correct for everything that might have an effect in the gene expression, and to do it before we will do the comparison between the case control, so in our case, between the gastric cancer and the control. And one of those factors would be, of course, the cell type. So that's why we, first of all, we wanted to run the deconvolution analysis, because if we run the analysis between the gastric cancer and control, and we will have a gene that is going up in gastric cancer, we want to make sure that this gene is going up because of this specific disease, but not because of the higher proportion, for example, of T cells in our samples. And this is a T cell related gene. So we want to correct for those one. And we received actually a very interesting result. So this map is here very small, because you can imagine I analyzed, it was the long data sets, salivary humans of human saliva, but it was 200 of the samples. So it's very, very difficult to see it on one heat map. But here we can see the closer view. And what we detected that actually in our samples, there was a higher proportion of keratinocytes, neutrophils, and also of other cells that would make very sense because we are dealing with the saliva. And we have to consider it for further analysis to correct for these factors. And additionally, another major confounding factor is, of course, the patient-specific expression, because each patient is different and it can have a random effect on our gene expression. So in our analysis, we wanted to actually to correct everything what can affect the gene expression in the salivary cohort. And that's why we wanted to check which other factors, apart from the cell type, could contribute, could have the highest contribution to the variance. And we ran the variance partition. So in this way, we find out the contribution of all other factors to the overall variance. And we see also similarly that the neutrophils and keratinocytes has the most variance. And also we checked for other patient-specific factors, like for example, age, like gender. We also checked other factors that were specific for our disease, gastric cancer, like drinking, smoking, H. pylori infection, and so on. So later on, taking in consideration our analysis, we could correct in for all those factors before we will run the case versus control comparison. And here is another graph, just the bar graph of the, we see all the top genes, but actually we see that not only those genes, but those genes are group, they are sorted by the group. So what does it mean? So group is case versus control, gastric cancer versus control. Those genes are grouped where the case control is the most relevant factor. So it has the most variance. But we can see also what is the contribution of other factors apart from the group to on the expression of those specific genes. We also ran the correlation analysis, and what we can see, we were interested the group factor with what other factors it can correlate. And actually in our analysis, we see that it correlates with T cells. And what was interesting also H with H. pylori infection. So maybe if we get older, we will have more severe H. pylori infection. So later on, in our analysis, so before we will run the traditional comparison between gastric cancer and control, we wanted to correct for everything that could affect our gene expression. So, so all the patient-specific things like that could, you know, cause the random effect, and also other factors like the different cell types, the H. pylori infection, smoking, drinking, and so on. So we were searching for any analytical method that would allow us to correct for all those factors before we will run the traditional analysis, case versus control, gastric cancer versus control. And in this way, we could not use the regular linear model, but we use the mixed effects linear model because it would allow us to correct for all of those, specifically for the random effects, so those patient-specific things. And actually, the results were this time very, very promising, and we detected a lot of very significant genes. Those are just the pilot study that we did, and we still need a little bit to work more on our deconvolution results and other variance partition. Maybe because of saliva has other also components that we should include in our deconvolution analysis. But the results are very promising, and what we detected that a lot, for example, some of the genes were actually the H. pylori infection genes, which makes sense for the gastric cancer because H. pylori is one of the highest risk factor for developing this disease. And we can easily check which those specific genes were involved in those specific pathways, like Helicobacter pylori infection. There is just another way of presenting our genome.
Karolina, we need to wrap up soon.
Yes. And what we see a greater interest in the salivary xRNA publications recently. So just to find out, so salivary xRNA has fundamental properties, including like high content of the bacterial component. That's why that warrant the design of unique additional steps that when we perform the bioinformatic analysis, like for example, we have to filter out the bacteria reads or apply more stringent criteria. And in the end, I just wanted to acknowledge all the collaborations that we developed during performance of this project. Specifically, I would want to thank my PI at the UCLA, Professor David Wong, and our collaborator, Dr. Yong Kim and Dr. Feng Li, and of course, the MRR group, Dr. Joy, Robert Kitchen, NCI, Dr. Rapkin and Camargo, the Samsung Medical Center, and Dr. Kendall Jensen. Thank you very much.